Welcome to Prophecy in the News. I'm your host, Kevin Clarkson. My guest today is Bill Salus. Hello, Bill.
Hello, Dr. Clarkson.
To those who may not know Bill, he is a real student of biblical prophecy for probably the last, 30 years or more of your life. More in depth in publishing and researching and writing books and making DVDs in these last several years. But I enjoy your approach and your insights.
Well, thank you very much for that. And the books I've written here, we offer them through Prophecy in the News, and I thank you for carrying them here.
Absolutely. And we look forward to you being at our Prophecy in the News Prophecy Summit this summer at Pikes Peak.
I'm excited about that. That lineup of speakers is just phenomenal.
It'll be the third week of June.
Yes, yes. So I certainly invite every one of you to come there. I got a lot of great messages I want to share with you. Very relevant, very timely.
We'll soon be sharing full-length shows with you that we do with Bill about his newest studies, and it's called the Now Prophecies. And really, as we look at what's happening right now this week as we're making an update, Brother Bill, it's really caught our attention. The so-called Syrian civil war really has not only the whole world's gaze, but all of the Middle East is kind of afraid right now.
Right. You know, we were talking in a prior update, and I invite you viewers to watch that prior update because it sets the stage for what we're going to talk about right here. You know, Russia's gotten involved in the Syrian revolution, and they've tipped the scales in favor of the Bashar al-Assad regime staying in power. Now, will this just die out that way, or will the Sunni Arab states, which are also very concerned right now, we were talking about how they actually have major war drills and things like that, Saudi Arabia, etc.
Hundreds of thousands of troops.
Yeah, will they enter in? Will this now become a very convoluted mess that leads into a massive war, maybe another world war, because you're going to have different coalitions of forces fighting like we had in the world wars.
Mm-hmm.
But what we didn't talk about too much, I'd mentioned that this could have biblical prophetic implications. Maybe we should take a moment to talk about some of that.
Let's do, and let's just give the obvious caveat that we say that this may peter out. We don't know. We don't always realize prophecy until just as it happens and we can see it. Sometimes on the front side of it, you're trying to see it, mm-hmm. But if this certainly goes on these directions, it can set the stage for some big things.
And what we want to qualify is that when we talk about Bible prophecies, these are events that the Lord felt were extremely important, especially when you talk about end times Bible prophecies. They're important because they will have a global impact.
That's right.
So even though the events we're talking about are primarily centered in the Middle East, it doesn't mean they're going to confine their ramifications to the Middle East. We're already experiencing terrorism coming into our backyard in the San Bernardino. Of course, we had 9/11 and things like that. So we need not to be aloof about these things in America. We need to take these things to heart and be aware of them.
That's exactly right. You made the excellent point that, you know, not everything that happens is foretold in the Bible, but a lot of it actually is essential to setting up what is going to happen in the Bible.
Right, like 9/11, powerful event, yes. The Arab Spring. I think that's a stage. These are stage-setting events for the biblical prophecies that are about to happen. They weren't Bible prophecies. Mm-hmm. They were important for us. So how important are the actual Bible prophecies that centuries ago the Lord said to the prophets, write these down. These are the events I want you to write about. And these are the ones that I think are coming upon us. I think some of them, I call them now prophecies in the book, because they have minimal to no preconditions. They're essentially imminent. We could wake up one morning, and I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. Isaiah 17 could find fulfillment, the destruction of Damascus. It says in Isaiah 17, verse 1, where the Syrian revolution's been going on since 2011, that someday Damascus will cease from being a city, it'll be a ruinous heap. This is a very, very real possibility, that's very prophecy.
That's the oldest continuously inhabited city in the world, and yet Isaiah said one day it'll be a ruinous heap.
Yeah, literally reduced to rubble. And in the last verse of Isaiah 17, it says overnight. You know, one night you see it, the next morning you don't. And what's interesting is it says in verse 9, the desolation is caused by the children of Israel, the Israeli Defense mm-hmm. Forces. Now, let's take that for a minute. First of all, if you read the whole prophecy, it's not Israel being an aggressor. They are responding to protection, self-defense. But the reality is Israel has struck Syria a few times over the last couple of years. They're concerned about Iran moving weapons into Hezbollah's hands through Syria. Syria has said, if you strike us, someday we'll retaliate and we'll hit Tel Aviv. And the response from Israel is, you hit Tel Aviv, we hit Damascus, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is a very volatile situation, very fluent situation over there. And with all the firepower that's amassing around Israel right now, you know, I mean, one bad situation, one bad missile falling in the wrong place, and it could open a whole powder keg, and the next thing you know, you could have the destruction of Damascus.
Well, as we think about the events of this week and this gathering of forces from different nations and the possibility, what do you think are some applications for us right now?
Right. Well, you know, one of the things I've focused on in the Now Prophecies book is a prophecy that I think has been kind of vastly overlooked in Jeremiah chapter 49, verses 1 through 6, and it's dealing with Jordan. You know, Jordan is sort of this fish out of the water over there right now. They have that treaty with Israel in 1994. Mm-hmm. They still don't recognize Israel's right to exist. The treaty was more lucrative for them. It was more politically expedient than something they really wanted, and it's really paper thin at this point. If we have a moment, why don't you read those six verses, because I think we might find something here that's relevant for our time.
I can do that. This is Jeremiah 49, verses 1 through 6, and I'm reading from the King James.
Okay.
Concerning the Ammonites, and of course, current-day capital of Jordan is called Ammon, which
right,
is
exactly
related etymologically. Concerning the Ammonites, thus saith the Lord, hath Israel no sons? Hath he no heir? Why then doth their king inherit Gad, and his people dwell in his cities? Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will cause an alarm of war to be heard in Rabbah of the Ammonites, and it shall be a desolate heap. Same phrase, almost.
Interesting.
As
yeah.
Damascus. Mm-hmm. And her daughters shall be burned with fire, and then shall Israel be heir unto them that were his heirs, saith the Lord. Howl, O Heshbon, for Ai is spoiled. Cry, ye daughters of Rabbah. Gird ye with sackcloth, lament, and run to and fro by the hedges, for their king shall go into captivity, and his priests and his princes together. Wherefore gloriest thou in the valleys, thy flowing valley, O backsliding daughter, that trusted in her treasures, saying, Who shall come unto me? Behold, I will bring a fear upon thee, saith the Lord God of hosts, from all those that be about thee. And ye shall be driven out every man after forth, and none shall gather unto him that wondereth. And afterward I will bring again the captivity of the children of Ammon, saith the Lord.
Interesting. So the good news, I will bring back the captivity.
I caught that.
I will bring. There will be a remnant.
The goodness of God, the mercy of God.
There will be a remnant that comes to know Jesus as the Messiah, and ultimately they'll be restored. And the theme of a remnant in the Bible is throughout. Israel will have a remnant. Egypt will, Assyria, Jordan, Iran will actually have a remnant too. I write about this prophecy extensively in the book, so we'll just take a moment to talk about some of the critical verses that may be relevant right now. One thing it said in verse 5, is that there's going to be a fear all around Jordan. Okay, the chapter I write about is called The Trembling and Toppling of Jordan, and it's related to these verses you read. Right now, Jordan is surrounded by fear. King Abdullah II, this fear is spoken of there, I believe it applies right now. As I've studied the history of Jordan, it's never applied since Jeremiah wrote this about 2,500 years ago, like it does right now. So I believe this is a prophecy for right now. And they're surrounded by the Syrian revolution to the north. Now you got Russia in there. Israel's got an eye on what's going on. They're watching the Golan Heights just to the north of Jordan. Lebanon shooting Hezbollah through there, you know, into Syria now. The Sinai, Israel's even building a fence that goes through the bottom of Jordan now because the terrorism, ISIS has got terrorist connections through the Sinai.
That's what we saw when we were there.
Yeah, they've exploded the gas lines, and Jordan needs that. There's been several explosions on that, the natural gas that goes through there. Iran now getting involved, you know, maybe getting nuclear weapons. King Abdullah is so concerned, he's come over and visit Barack Obama three times over the last year and a half, talking about the ISIS refugee crisis, the Syrian refugee crisis, the ISIS terrorists getting into his country. Jordan could be the next country to be toppled. He is fearful right now of what's surrounding him. And ultimately what it said in the first couple of verses, there's an alarm of war in the capital of Jordan, Amman. And it says it'll be a desolate heap. Some translations, a desolate mound. Now, you know, for your West Coast viewers, the difference between Amman, Jordan, and Damascus, Syria, who also had a prophecy we talked about with the destruction of Damascus, is about a drive from Los Angeles to San Diego. I mean, it's not that far apart from each other, and it sounds like we're dealing with a similar scenario because it says Israel will take possession of its inheritance in those verses you read. Well,
rather parallel.
Israel's involved again now, okay? Why would some other person, some other country destroy Jordan, because it says alarm of war, it'll be reduced to rubble, a ruinous, desolate mound. And why would Israel move in and take over the land unless Israel was the one that made it a desolate mound, right? They wouldn't just
Makes sense, yeah.
come in on someone else's military coattails. So I'm talking to your viewers here, Kevin. I mean, this stuff was written centuries ago. It was not intended to be on the parchment forever. It's going to hit the pavement, and I think it's going to start to hit the pavement real soon.
Well, we need to keep our eye in the Middle East and keep our eye on the sky, because Jesus is returning.
Absolutely, Kevin.
So we're going to keep looking up. Thank you for joining us.